Let's pray. Lord Jesus Christ, you have made us one in you. You've made us one family together, that near or far, we are united in you, Jesus. We thank you that you united us to each other and to the Father through your blood. We ask, Lord, this morning that you would open our ears, open our hearts to your word, that as we hear it, Lord, we would trust it, and open up my mouth, Lord, to speak your message clearly. Jesus, we pray this through your precious name. Amen. All right, so show of hands, first off, how many of you have seen the movie Saving Private Ryan? Raise your hand if you've seen it. All right, for all of you who have not raised your hands, spoiler alert, I'm going to ruin the whole movie for you. Okay? I'm sorry. not sorry. Hashtag. So it's a, I put the hashtag in the wrong place. If you're a kid, don't watch it for a while. It's a pretty brutal movie, okay? Parents, don't show it to your kids. It's a brutal R-rated movie, okay? It's a war movie. It's set back in World War II, all right? And basically the gist of it is this. There's a guy named Private Ryan who needs saving, right? You wouldn't have figured that out from the title. So Private Ryan is stuck behind enemy lines, and there's a group of soldiers that are sent in to go find him and bring him home safely. And so the movie follows this group of soldiers going to save Private Ryan. They find him, and they bring him home. They end up losing a lot of men in the process, right? There's a sacrifice of life that happens. It's a high cost. And we're going to watch a clip in a second from the very end of the movie. This is after Ryan has been saved, after he's been brought home, and this is decades in the future, okay? And he's standing at the grave of one of the soldiers who sacrificed his life for him. And I want you to watch Private Ryan on the screen here, and I want you to ask yourself this question. What is it that Ryan is struggling with as he stands at this grave?
With you, I wasn't sure how I'd feel coming back here. Every day, I think about what you said to me that day on the bridge. I've tried to live my life the best I could. I hope that was enough. I hope that at least in your eyes, I've earned what all of you have done for me.
James, Captain John H. Miller.
Tell me I've led a good life.
What?
Tell me I'm a good man.
You are.
What did you hear him struggling with? And their sacrifice? Why someone would give it all? Was he worth the sacrifice? You guys hear anything else? Did he do enough? Did he live a good life that was worth it? Friends, we're approaching a time in the church year called Holy Week, right? And in Holy Week, we're walking towards a graveyard. And that graveyard has only one cross and only one sacrifice. It's a big cross. It's a cross that's even bigger than the ones that they were standing in front of in the movie. And it was a price that was paid that was even greater, right? That God the Son came into our world, went through hell to save us, to take us from the kingdom of the prince of the air and take us into God's good kingdom, his kingdom of life. And that Jesus Christ, perfection incarnate, right? He came into this war zone that you and I live in. He suffered, he died for our sins to bring us to safety. Right, that we were dead in our trespasses and sin. We were separated from God because of our sins. We were actually on the side of the enemy, Satan. And you know that if you're on the side that's opposing God, that's not going to end well for you, right? That our destiny was destruction. Our destiny was annihilation. Our destiny was damnation. And yet, because of God's great love for us, he sent his son Jesus. That even while you and I were wearing the enemy uniforms, even while we were in the wrong camp, Jesus died. And not only that, then he rose from the grave to give us new life so that when we had new life, we would come to life on God's side. Now we're on the side of Jesus. We're seated with him eternally. And that means we get victory and everything that comes along with it, right? We get eternal goodness and eternal newness and eternal joy and eternal life, right? Paul said it this way. We've been walking through the book of Ephesians. He said this earlier in Ephesians 2 as he's talking about how the Jew and the Gentile, they were separated because of the law. They were separated from each other because of the law, and they were separated from God because of the law, right? Because there was sin. And Paul talks about Jesus stepping into that and fixing it with his sacrifice. Paul says this, and we're going to read it together. But now in Christ Jesus, you who were far off have been brought near by the blood of Christ. For he himself is our peace, who has made us both one and has broken down in his flesh the dividing wall of hostility by abolishing the law of commandments expressed in ordinances, that he might create in himself one new man in place of the two, so making peace, and might reconcile us both to God in the one body through the cross, thereby killing the hostility. Friends, through Jesus Christ, through his very body and blood, Jesus reconciled us. Reconcile means to take what is broken and to fix it. He took us that were broken in our relationships with God and with each other, and he made them one. He fixed them. We've been made right with God, no matter our background, no matter what we've done, no matter our heritage. We've been made one with God, and we've been made one with each other. We're no longer stuck in the war zone. We're no longer stuck in the enemy camp. Instead, we've been brought into safety. We've been brought home. Why? Because Jesus, the uniter, united us who were at war with God and united us to God himself. He brought peace and unity between us and the Father and between us and each other where there was no peace and unity before. This is a free gift from God. And friends, as with many free gifts, we look at it and we realize, we can't do anything to earn this. We can't do anything to be worth what Jesus went through for us. And maybe like Private Ryan, we sit and we struggle with that sacrifice of whether we're worthy of that sacrifice. I know that I struggle when I see the cross. I struggle when I get to Good Friday. I struggle when I watch the Passion of the Christ and look at what Jesus went through. I struggle when I look at my own life and say, man, am I worth that? Like, am I good enough for that? Why would Jesus go through that for me? Why would he do that sacrifice for me? I don't like the answers I come up with when I ask those questions. Maybe you don't either. Maybe you're like me and you feel a little guilty and you don't feel like you're worthy and you don't feel like you're good. And yet, instead of looking at us and what we've done, instead of looking inside of us like we do, Jesus takes us by the chin and he gently lifts us up from looking at ourselves to look at him. And he speaks to you and he speaks to me. You may not be worthy, but I am. See, friends, the grace of Christ is this. The gift of God is this, that even though you and I are not worthy, Jesus is worthy, and he's worthy for you. He's worthy for you. And as we've read in Ephesians, that Jesus takes us, he takes you and he takes me. He takes us who were strangers and aliens in the household of God. He takes us who were dead in our trespasses and sin. He takes us who were enemies because of the sin that we commit. And he takes us and he builds us into his very body. He builds us into his family. He builds us into his dwelling place, into his very church here on earth. He chooses us. Jesus makes us good. He makes us holy. He makes us clean. He makes us pure. He makes us beloved. He makes us alive. He makes us one with God and one with our brothers and sisters. Why? Because Jesus is all of those things. We are not worthy, but he is. And he gives it to us. This is what Paul has been trying to get across to us in all of our readings from the past weeks, from the first three chapters of Ephesians. This is what Paul is trying to convince us of, that God has given us such grace in Christ. This is why he ends, as we did last week, as Pastor Tony was sharing us with us, that oxymoronic prayer of praying that the Holy Spirit would give us the strength to comprehend the uncomprehendable. That we would comprehend the love that surpasses all understanding that we find in Christ Jesus. And we learn from those three chapters, man, that God just gives and gives and gives, and we as Christians just receive and receive and receive. He's the giver and we're the recipients. And so today we're starting Ephesians 4. And our text today starts with a little word, therefore. And as y'all know, there's a great theological question that goes along with the word therefore. And the question is, what is the therefore? Yeah. Therefore, and what it's doing is it's summing up, this therefore sums up all that has come before in our first three chapters of Ephesians. The grace of God in Christ for all of us. It sums all that up, and then it says, because of that, it shifts to an application in chapters 4 through 6, and that's what we'll be going into. What do we do after we receive God's gifts? And so Paul begins with this therefore today, these six verses, and starts it with that therefore. Therefore, because of God's great and free gift of love for us in Christ. Therefore, because Jesus has taken all of us and brought us into God's family and made us one with the Father and made us one with each other. Therefore, because Jesus loves us with a great love that is able to accomplish more than we could ever comprehend. Therefore, because Jesus can bring about a greater salvation than you or I could ever imagine, a salvation that no eye has seen and no ear has heard of. Therefore, because God has acted first in Jesus, therefore, Paul says, respond by walking in a manner worthy of the calling. Now, we don't live our lives as Christians in a certain way because of guilt, or as if we could pay Jesus back for what he's done for us. No, instead we're certain of our present reality of Jesus. We're certain that we're loved. We're certain of our future destination in Jesus, that everything will be made new. And because of that, we walk out our lives, we live out our Christian lives out of thankfulness. Out of thankfulness for what Jesus has done for us. And out of a desire that other people would experience that through us, that they would get glimpses of the goodness of God in our lives, that we know how good God is, and we want other people to know too. And so we walk in a manner worthy to which we've been called. Paul starts off by talking about, therefore, walk with humility. And you think about it, you've been called by Christ. You've been called holy and pure and blameless and loved. So walk with humility. You have nothing to prove. You have nothing to prove to God. You have nothing to prove to anybody else. What could be better than what God has already spoken to you? So walk with humility. You can care about your neighbor. You can care about the other people. You can lay yourself down for others. Why? Because God is taking care of you. So walk with humility. Walk with gentleness. That even though you were dead in your sins, Jesus raised you to new life. He was gentle with you when you deserved wrath. So be gentle to others. Walk with gentleness. That when you come across people who really honestly deserve your anger, deserve your wrath, remember how you deserved Jesus' wrath, and instead he gave you gentleness. And from that understanding of things, right, you can turn the other cheek. And you can give your tunic too, and you can walk an extra mile, and you can pray for those who persecute you, and you can do good to those who harm you. Walk with gentleness. Paul continues, he says, walk with patience. Oh, friends, our God is patient with us. He's patient with me. You know, even though Jesus is pouring his spirit in each and every one of us, man, I don't know if you're anything like me, I keep stumbling on the same stupid things over and over and over again. I do the same dumb sins, and I repent and I do them again, and I repent and I do them again. And Paul says he's in the same boat. And maybe you're like Paul and I. And you know what? Our God is patient with us. He doesn't blast us even when we're stiff-necked. He forgives us and forgives us and forgives us. Our God gives forgiveness even to us Christians. And so walk with patience. Maybe there are people in your lives that really do the same dumb things over and over again. Remember how God was patient with you. And be patient with them. Overlook those little slights. Forgive those sins that are done. Encourage them to do better. Pray for them. But be patient. Be patient and walk with them in love. Friends, the reason why we walk in this way, in this humble, gentle, patient way, in this way of being eager to maintain the unity that Jesus has won, we do this why? We do it because of who? Jesus. We do it because of Jesus and what he's done. We do it because Jesus is the one that has united us. Jesus is the uniter. He's the one who brought peace and unity when there was none. Friends, we sometimes think that peace and unity has to be built by us, but peace and unity are not something that's man-made. It never was and it never can be. We're always going to get in the way. Only Jesus could bring about peace and unity, because only Jesus can knock down those dividing walls. Only Jesus can fulfill the law. Only Jesus can pay for the sins that keep us from our Father, and only Jesus can pay for the sins that keep us from our brothers and sisters in Christ. Only Jesus can make us one family with the Father of all and with our brothers and sisters. Because of Jesus and Jesus alone, friends in Christ, we are one family, and no one can take that away, and nothing can take that away. And there is a oneness in God through Jesus. And Paul goes on in the rest of this text, and he talks about all the ones. He talks about the one body that was given on the cross for us. That one Spirit that dwells inside our hearts and points us to faith in Christ. That one hope that we each have, that hope that we're going to confess in a couple minutes in the Apostles' Creed, that hope that we are now having, we now have forgiveness of sins, that hope that one day when Jesus returns to judge the living and the dead, there's going to be a resurrection of the body, that hope that one day we'll taste the entire fruits of everlasting life. There's one Lord, the one Lord Jesus Christ, who shed his blood as a new covenant with us, saying it's all good between us and God. There's one baptism where all our sins were washed away and buried in the ground, and we got to put on that newness of life, that resurrection power that Jesus himself has. And there's one God and Father of all, who is over all and through all and in all. That we're made one with him. That we'll never again be separated from the love of our Father. We'll never again be separated from the ones who are the Father's children. And that nothing in life, none of the darkness, none of the evil, none of the brokenness, Satan himself, nor even our sins, can separate us from him. Friends, we experience this. We experience this reality. We experience this oneness. God comes to us in it now. We experience this unity every time we encounter those promises of God. And he brings us those promises in his word, and he brings us those promises in baptism, and he brings us the promises in communion with the bread and wine. And that God promises to come to us in these places. Why? So that we can see and touch and taste. And he does it just for us, just like he's done for every believer in every place over all time. And that Jesus comes to us through the word, and we hear his voice, just as all the saints, no matter where they live, no matter how far apart they are, hear his voice. And in baptism, we are baptized into the same family. We become part of the same family that all Christians, whether they're Christians that really demonstrate their love well for us or whether they're Christians that sin against us, we're all baptized into the same body. And when we come to the altar, when we come forward and we receive the bread and the wine, the body and blood of Christ, we're united. We're eating the same meal with saints that have departed before us, and the saints who ain't even on earth yet. That we share in the same meal, the same feast. That in these places, in these promises, in this word, and in the water, and in the bread, and in the wine, we are united by Jesus Christ. We are united vertically with the Father. We're united horizontally with each other and every other Christian church. And every other Christian who ever lived. As we walk out this faith, as we walk out this unity, as we walk, however worthy we are, however good we are, Paul wants us to make sure we are assured of this and trust in this. Now that Jesus has brought you unity and peace, now that Jesus has made you one, nothing can tear us apart from God, and nothing can tear us apart from each other. The gates of hell won't prevail. The mistakes that I make won't prevail, and the brokenness of this world won't prevail. Why? Because Jesus is King, and Jesus is bigger than all the junk, and Jesus is on our side, and he is the uniter. Amen. Amen.